Welcome to Santo, Sam and Ed's Total Football.
This man, FFA Football Hall of Fame, Medal of Excellence 2010.
Yes.
What about 1975 to 1981? He played for a little team called the Socceroos. Mm. 20 appearances. He is now the head honcho down at Adidas. They're doing all great work and supplying me with such great jerseys such as this one. So I put my name in so you can't have it back. Can you please welcome the wonderful Jimmy Tansey.
Jimmy,
hello, mate. You've been one of the first, when we first started doing this for Cup Fever, Santo has always been saying, we've got to get my mate Jimmy on, we've got to get my mate Jimmy on. He's a former Socceroo. And well, then, Sam, are you going to start with your favourite statistic about Jimmy's playing career?
First of all, with Cup Fever, we did 26 shows and we didn't have you on.
No, I know, but that's... I was trying to pass that.
Sorry. Yeah.
Never made the cost.
I know this for a fact. You try to keep this up, but you got sent off in your last game ever.
Last professional game sent off.
Correct.
Yeah. did you show up at the tribunal?
Inglorious end to my career. Actually, no. I made a phone call and I was due to turn up at the tribunal and I said, look, it's all over. Forget it. I'm finished.
Yeah.
So finished.
So you pleaded indifference.
Finished.
Well, that's amazing. Can I just say, I saw Jimmy last week. I was going on a bike ride, and I saw Jimmy and his mate coming out of a pub at about 4 in the afternoon. And I said, what are you doing? We just come out of the pub. And goes, what are you about to do now? We're going to go to the fish and chip shop and then go to another pub. To watch the Melbourne Victory game.
You see, my partner happened to be overseas, so we were looking at things to, you know, keep ourselves occupied, and football and beer and things
perfect.
Like that.
Yeah,
Saturday afternoon.
Yeah, yeah.
I mean, I'm sure the guys would agree. It's not a bad way to spend a day.
Exactly right. Right. Why would we do that?
Let's get some
football.
Well, I was going to say, because it does seem like we're just all, you know, great mates and like, but you do have some football credentials, Jimmy. Mm.
Mm-hmm.
Your time with the Socceroos, 20 appearances, no goals. But
he was a fullback.
Oh. 1975 to 1981, though, that's a time that is foreign to me, and I'd love to hear about it, Jimmy.
Well, like, first of all, I should say that when I came to Australia in the early 70s, and I mean, I love this country. I was naturalised after 3 years, but. You know, we also had, we played for the state team then, the Victim. We used to have some great games and great teams used to come out, New York Cosmos, Rangers, and some capacity crowds at the old Olympic Park there.
Yeah.
But also you had a job as well.
Oh, what was your job?
And my job was working on the building site. You took that much time off to try and play football that you couldn't really hold down a job.
I'll finish that wall when I get back.
Yeah, exactly.
So the guys from overseas, they were professional players, and playing against you guys who just had, after the game, you have a Monday job.
Literally, you played at a full house at Olympic Park on a Wednesday night, and I was out fixing the concrete wall on Thursday morning at 7 o'clock.
Well, how I feel after I do this show, and then tomorrow I'm driving people around. It's the same thing.
We want to talk about some of the conditions. In the old days of the Socceroos, like in the 70s when you were playing, like now, you know, we're saying that the Western Sydney Wanderers are flying out to Riyadh tomorrow night, and we know they're going to be going there. The Socceroos, you remember they do the advanced parties for the World Cup where we scout which lodge we're going to live in for the Socceroos. To make life as easy as possible in five-star luxury. I imagine it was exactly the same in the 70s.
Absolutely, absolutely. We, you know, when you thought rehydration was having a couple of beers, but...
what kind of joints would you be putting on?
You know, we were lucky to get in the Travel Lodge.
Ooh.
And now I'm out giving product to the current internationals and the intercontinentals, so there's a slight difference there.
Hang on, I heard once when you were flying overseas that you guys got upgraded to non-smoking.
I didn't know what an upgrade was till after I finished playing.
Yeah, wait, you can go left at this point.
Let's show some. There's a picture of you and Gary Cole. I'm presuming it's somewhere.
What is
somewhere
that? Okay, so where are we here, Jimmy? What's going on?
Well, you've caught me with this one. I would say that was in Beijing in 74.
Wow. Before Nixon even got there.
We were actually one of the first sporting teams into Beijing, and that was absolutely amazing because there was hardly any cars, mass bicycles all over the place.
Yeah.
And there was 85,000 in the stadium.
How'd you go?
First time, I think we won 3-2.
Nice. Ah. Okay.
But I must say, a couple of guys did overhead kicks.
Yeah. Wow.
And the crowd went crazy. So all of a sudden, the guys knew if you did an overhead kick, you'd get a massive, crowd would go. So everyone was doing overhead kicks. Which is quite difficult for me playing at the back rather than give a goal away.
I thought when the goalie did it twice, they scored. So. Terrible idea.
And the day after you were there, did they put you to work on the Great Wall of China?
You're in the building industry.
It took them 3 months to get there. There's another picture. I saw a fantastic picture of you with George Best.
The great George Best.
He's the guy with the beard. Okay, now he is like really Palais Maradona. You've got George Best is up. What was going on there? Where was that? Because there's a guy holding a Foster's tin.
Yeah.
I'm presuming that's in Australia.
George came to Australia. I can't remember the year, but I'll say very early 80s and. He played a charity match at Doncaster, and I mean George Best, legend. And I actually sort of mocked him, but said, "George, do what you like. You're a legend. You know, I'm not going to kick you." And George took great lengths to explain that he'd actually had a drinking problem, probably because he couldn't get enough. But George invited us out, and he'd gone to great lengths to explain that he'd had a stapling program in his stomach. And we went out, and he had the biggest wine holder full of champagne behind the table and proceeded to get. So I was very interested to find out what happened about that. But at the end of the night, it all disappeared and George had finished off the champagne.
Well, Santo has a similar thing. It's got Campari right there. Jimmy, I want to. During the last couple of weeks, we have been showing, I showed Ed at 17, Santo at 17. Who else did we
show? We showed you at 17.
What were you doing at 17, Jimmy? Because John Aloisi, for instance, last week told us that he was in Belgium already trying to get a full-time professional job.
I was playing at 17, playing part-time professional, holding down a job in Liverpool, where I was born. Yeah. And that's what you did.
Not all these questions have great answers.
So that's. John
was in Spain. I was working.
You can't go month by month through the 70s, Sam. It's only one-hour show.
Well, I was going to say,
I've got some footage.
Well, we don't have any vision of you playing at 17. Of course, there was no moving pictures then, Jimmy.
We've invited this guy onto the show.
Your career actually predates photography. So all we could find, Jimmy, was this beautiful sketch of you.
Does that bring
back memories, though, Jimmy?
Don't you realise he works for Adidas? You will never be receiving anything in your life with three stripes on it.
Amazing.
In fact, let's go to the Adidas years because this is really interesting. Now, so you're at Adidas at the moment?
Yeah.
Or have been for a while?
I have been for a long time.
For 32 years now. Oh, okay. 32 years.
Can I ask you very quickly about the Messi-Ronaldo thing? Because I read a lot about how, well, because Messi he wears Adidas boots and has done since he was very young, but because he plays for Barcelona, they're sort of Nike and Adidas sort of split the Messi revenue, and Ronaldo's the exact opposite because he's over at Madrid and he's got Nike boots on, but he's got the Real Madrid shirt on his back. So would you swap Messi for Ronaldo in that situation?
That would be very easy to do, and everybody would be happy in the commercial world. But not possible.
Mm.
But I mean, would we swap them for anybody for David Beckham, though?
Really? Is David Beckham
he's the guy?
Well, I think David Beckham transcends the sport.
Yeah.
For example, if David Beckham goes to Wimbledon, all of a sudden the focus shifts from tennis to David Beckham, and he always looks $1 million and is an icon. And and I've been fortunate enough to meet him on several occasions, and a charming guy.
Wow.
Charming
guy.
Just quickly, just on the Adidas has had the contract on the balls for the World Cup. Can you just let us, as an insider, People complain about that they move too much. How much politics goes on inside of Adidas when they design those balls?
Look, there's massive research goes on, Santo, to make that ball. And obviously, in the perfect world, everybody's got to be happy, but you just can't keep everybody happy. Most of the people who complain, you'll find, are the goalkeepers.
Yeah, that's right. That's
what they do, yeah.
Yeah, yeah. And the game is about goals. People remember goals. Mm. So the... the last World Cup was fantastic.
Yeah, the ball was fantastic. The goals were flying in. Yeah.
No complaints. So,
I've said for a long time that goalies shouldn't be allowed to use their hands, but that's a topic for another day. We've got to get out of here. Can you please thank Jimmy Tansey? Yeah. Yeah. Back with Midnight on Total Football.